It's 89.9 KCRW. Morning Becomes Eclectic. Tame Impala's 2010 album, Inner Speaker, was an immediate sensation here at KCRW. And by the end of the year, made many of our DJs' picks for the best album of the year. The Australian band's follow-up, Lonerism, continued the cosmic road trip, and we've been anxiously awaiting their return to our KCRW studios. We're here with Kevin Parker. Hello, Kevin.
Hey.
How are you?
Pretty good.
Thanks for coming back to the station.
Oh, no worries. It's a pleasure.
So would you say this second album was a continuation of the first, or did it feel like a very distinct chapter for you?
Yeah, I mean, I kind of changed everything, the way I was doing everything.
How so?
In all sense of the word, like it was a different kind of place. Like with the first album, we rented a house. We sort of took all this gear that we borrowed, heaps of gear, and we did it. We're trying to sort of fit it into the normal recording band, recording label setup, where there'd be a studio. We'd book 7 weeks. We put it into 7 weeks. We did it, you know, blah blah blah, quite structured. But with this one, I kind of just realized that there's no need for that kind of structure, and I just totally went back to the way I've been doing it since I was a kid, you know, just in a room. It used to be my bed, or it used to be sort of the garage or something. Now I just, the one of the rooms in my house, I just turned into a studio, and just basically locked myself away for as long as I was doing the album. It was just a totally different way of doing it from the first album. And I was using different recording stuff, different instruments, more instruments, different stuff, just even different ways of writing songs. I don't know, because of that environment change, because I didn't feel the pressure of time, you know. There was no time restraint, which is something I can't really find creativity under time pressure, you know. I need to know that I can go all night and all next day and all week just doing drums, you know, if I want to.
So were you able to begin writing for this album while on the road for the last album?
Yeah. In a way, a lot of the songs came out that way. I mean, there's never really any correlation between where you are and whether or not you're going to write a song. It can come anytime, you know. It's kind of just like a flash of an idea.
You know, we don't usually bring up mix engineers, mixers on records, but I wanted to mention Dave Friedman, who seems to have become a trusted part of your process, and I'd love for you to talk about his role and maybe what he's brought to the table for you.
He bridges the gap between me having this idea of the sound overall, the overall kind of way it all fits together sonically and emotionally and everything, and being able to actually do that, you know. Because what he does is the one thing I can't do, which is just create this amazing sounding mix, which is just really pops out at you and gives the song that extra kind of like cosmic crunch. Sounds like a chocolate bar.
But also there's so much going on in your music that that's a really important role to play, because I guess he's got to kind of rein it all in, because it's very layered and sort of just dreamy and epic. And yeah, I mean, that's an important part of the process.
Yeah, exactly. That's why it's so hard for me, for starters. And, you know, it's got to be someone like him, because he has this way of turning a complete soup of sounds, a potential mud swamp of psychedelic noises, into like a pleasant rhythmic kind of, you know, groovy song. Yeah. It's easy just to get absolutely lost in like the amount of synthesizers and guitars and delay noises and stuff, you know.
But he seems to get the balance right, because it's not watered down. I mean, it still really takes you on this journey.
Exactly. That's the mystical unknown magic of Dave Friedman.
Have you kind of felt a pressure to format your songs differently or more traditionally, because they are such a kind of trip that is not, you know, bound to traditional structure of songs? Mm-hmm. I mean, is that in your mind at all, or do you just like it to be a jam?
I actually forgot about the whole song structure thing until about three quarters of the way through the album. And I had this sort of freak out that I had totally disregarded the purpose of like a song structure, you know, the thing that really like gets the listener, you know, involved in the song, like verse, chorus, whatever. And I suddenly had this freak out. I thought no one was going to be able to actually listen to it because the passages and stuff were totally just not related to anything. It was like, it wouldn't go verse, chorus. It'd go like this bit, kind of like a start with something that sounds like a chorus and then go into like a second chorus, and then that would be like an interlude and then a verse, and then maybe go back to the first bit. Because it was totally just stream of consciousness kind of way of putting it together.
Yeah.
And I didn't really, I was just doing it, I was just sort of doing it in the way I liked to hear it, you know, like, oh, now we should go to this bit, and then now we should go to this bit. And there was never any concern for like sitting down and actually thinking about the song as a whole, as a structure thing, and how other songs are structured. But I mean, I guess that in the end I kind of appreciated it because it was just a way I was recording. I was recording on like a with like an electronic musician's program on a computer.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't, with the first album, it was like an 8-track where I'd have to actually work out what I was going to do before I started recording. But with this one, you can just, it's for DJs and electronic producers and stuff, you know, so you can just literally throw down ideas quickly and you can just mash everything up and change it around. And it just comes out sounding sort of like a song, sort of like a jam, you know. I don't
Now, you've explored some other productions, too. I don't know where you found the time, but Melody's Echo Chamber. I know Pond is an associated band. Mm-hmm. It's yours, and we love both of those albums. What's your role on those projects?
On Melody's Echo Chamber, I was producing it, basically. And on Pond, I just... the last Pond album, Beardwives Denim, I played drums on it for most of the songs and mixed it.
Hmm.
We all have our hands in each other's pies all the time. You know, we're all kind of involved in each other's music. And I always forget that I played drums on that album, you know, just because we were all there recording and I was there with them. It's kind of, it seemed more important that I was just there with them. I was there rather than I actually played this or played that or did that. It's kind of just, you know, as long as we're involved in some way. Each other's stuff.
I wanted to ask you about the opening track, Be Above It, because the lyrics are interesting. You know, gotta be above it now. I know I can't let them bring me down. I wonder what you are referring to.
It's meant to be kind of like a self mantra. You know, the idea of, it's kind of meant to be someone walking along this kind of like rhythmic footsteps. Someone kind of blocking out the outside world, you know, for whatever purpose. And, the idea of trying not to let these encroaching negative thoughts get to you, you know, like the idea of other people kind of, I don't know, judging you or bringing you down in some way.
Sure.
Or, you know, someone or something or everyone, the general kind of outside world having this pressure on you. It's trying to sort of like block it out by just repeating these words to you. And it's mm-hmm. kind of like that, you know, like sticking your fingers in your ears and mm-hmm. yelling, you know, just, it's like meant to be kind of a musical interpretation of that, you know, of that kind of like, you know.
Well, it's an interesting point to make at the start of your sophomore record because, you know, a band's second album is always fraught with those expectations and those pressures, especially your first album made such a positive impression. And so I thought it was a smart kind of idea to just say, hey, I'm just going to focus here. I'm going to make a great right. record. I'm going to do what I love to do. Has anyone reached out to you who you really, truly admire and you've just been kind of beside yourself and thinking, wow, I can't believe, you know, this artist has contacted us and tried to connect?
Yeah, quite a few, actually. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if I should say, because if something doesn't happen, then it's going to be like, I flopped or whatever. But
that's cool.
One of the guys from the Chemical Brothers reached out a while ago, which was pretty amazing. Because I've always wanted to do something in that vein, but I've never really known how to dip my foot in it. But yeah, I mean, I don't know. Like, we might end up doing something. We might not. It might fall in a heap. Yeah, who knows? It's that kind of thing.
All right. Well, Kevin Parker, thank you for joining us. We love the band. We love the albums. And just keep doing great work. And we thank you for coming through KCRW.
Thanks, man. Cheers. Sure.
Cheers. Now let's get into second set, Tame Impala, live on KCRW.
That's you.